about two-thirds of all the whitetail shot in the U.S. Are taken with a firearm, you know, either a rifle or a shotgun. But with archery equipment, it's about a quarter, you know, about a quarter of all the deer. Now, the interesting part of that is that 15 years ago, it was only 15% of the total deer harvest was taken with a bow. So over the last decade and a half, there are a lot more deer being taken with a bow than there were in the past.
Big Buck Registry's Deer Hunting Podcast, episode number 277, the 2019 QDMA Whitetail Report with Kip Adams. Support for the Big Buck Registry and the Deer Hunt Podcast comes from Rackology, everything you need in one bag, now available at Rural King and Orsland Farm and Home storefronts, or online at www.rackology.org. Minus 33 Merino Wool Layering System. Timeless natural insulation, keeping you warm on the coldest days while staying breathable and wicking away moisture on the wet ones without the old school itch of regular wool. Grizzly Ears, the most advanced engineered wireless earbuds for the outdoors. Covert Scouting Cameras, remote cameras for hunting, wildlife, and security. Quiet Cat, the all-terrain electric bicycle. Visit quietcat.com. That's Q-U-I-E-T. KAT.com and use the discount code BIGBUCK15 to secure 15% off your next Quiet Cat purchase. And Big Buck merch. You can get cool, high quality Big Buck t-shirts, long sleeve t-shirts, and hoodies. And show support for this podcast by visiting www.bigbuckregistry.com/MERCH. Big Buck Registry is a virtual museum of hunting stories. We preserve a piece of Americana by interviewing and recording hunters about their hunts and experiences from across the country. And who knows, maybe we'll learn a thing or two along the way that'll help us take our hunt to the next level.
Hi, this is Dan Infold from huntingbeast.com. You're about to listen to one of my favorite podcasts, Big Buck Registry's Deer Hunting Podcast.
Hey, this is Hal Blood from Big Woods Bucks. And you're about to push play on my favorite podcast, the Big Buck Registry.
Hey, this is Zach Sandow at Onyx Hunt, and you're listening to one of my personal favorite podcasts, the Big Buck Registry.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, fellow predators. My name is Jay, and thank you for tuning in to the Big Buck Registry's Deer Hunting Podcast. For Dusty Phillips and Jim Keller and the entire staff here at the Big Buck Registry, welcome to this week's show. There are a couple things I'd like you to do for us if you could. If you would, please check us out on iTunes, subscribe, and leave us a review. With your help, we're going to try and push this show up the iTunes charts. I know we have a lot of listeners out there, and I need you to take some action. I need you to leave a review and subscribe to the show. If you do subscribe, that'll give you access and notification each and every week that a new show is released. You can also access this show in its entirety on YouTube, Stitcher, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, Spotify, Google Play, and as an Amazon Alexa skill. Go to Alexa and say, "Alexa, enable Big Buck Registry." It's all right there for you to access on demand at your fingertips. Regarding the harness program, we have an ample supply of harnesses to give away from our volunteer donors. If you're in need of a full body harness, please send an email to jay@bigbuckregistry.com. Per the QDMA Whitetail Report, hunters pursue whitetail deer more than any other species, and whitetail hunters contribute financially more than any other hunter segment. Whitetails are the foundation of the hunting industry. Because of this impressive impact, QDMA releases an annual report that goes deep into the data and identifies trends that affect the whitetail's world and the hunters that hunt them. We thought it only appropriate to invite Kip Adams back to discuss the highlights of this year's report, as we did last year. We plan to make it an annual event. We'll get to our entire interview with Kip Adams in just one moment, but before we do, let's hear from our friends at Rackology, Minus 33 Merino Wool Products, and Jim Keller with the Deer News.
Hey, it's Eric Fitzgerald here with Rackology. Wanted to visit you briefly about one of the most exciting products that we got in the market with Rackology. This is our food plot fertilizer. You can supplement your deer right through your food plot with this product. This is not your normal NPK. This has got so many goodies in this bag. Basically what it does is it makes your soil work for you so you can get by with just using fertilizer like this and not a lot of synthetics. If you want a good food plot and you want deer coming in and healthy, healthy plants, look at the food plot fertilizer through Rackology. Check us out at rackology.org. Thanks for tuning in.
Let's talk about a hunter's layering system for a sec. We need to be ready for any weather that Mother Nature throws at us. With the layering concepts that Minus 33 has created with their incredible merino wool products, they've got you covered. The Minus 33's merino wool expedition weight garments will keep you warm on the coldest late season days while regulating and wicking away moisture in a way that only merino wool can do. You see, wool will absorb up to 30% of its weight in moisture without leaving you feeling wet or clammy, and wool insulates better than cotton or polyester and protects against hypothermia on those late season hunts. And here's another interesting point. You might not think of wool for early season, but with the Minus 33 wicking technology, I'll take a lightweight Minus 33 base layer any day in warm weather. Merino wool fibers naturally reject any bacteria found in moisture or sweat and gives you double protection against odor as your target buck approaches. Visit www.minus33.com to learn more about Minus 33's layering technology. Use the code BIGBUCK33 to get 10% off your next order.
Now here's Jim Keller with the deer news.
Our first story this week: man poaches, then freezes 20-point buck. This story is from the American Hunter website. Indiana conservation officers report that a DuBois County man has pled guilty to illegally taking a potential record-breaking whitetail buck. Mark Gill, 56, shot a non-typical 20-point buck with more than 200 inches of antler in 2016 after previously taking a buck earlier in the year. In a clear violation of Indiana's one-buck regulation, Gill caped out the second buck he killed and kept it frozen for a year with the intention of claiming the kill the following season. Once the 2017 season rolled around, he took the buck to the check station and in doing so committed another crime by providing false information to Indiana's Deer Harvest Information System. Gill was caught and pled guilty to two charges: unlawful taking of a white-tailed deer, a Class B misdemeanor, and providing false information to a check station, a Class C misdemeanor. As part of Gill's plea agreement with the DuBois County Prosecutor's Office, his hunting license privileges are suspended for 2 years. Gill must also serve 100 hours of community service, serve 540 days probation, and pay $741 in fines and court costs, including a $500 replacement fee. Because Indiana is a member of the Interstate Wildlife Violator Compact, Gill's Indiana hunting license suspension will also result in a suspension of potential hunting, fishing, and trapping licenses in the other 47 member states, excluding Massachusetts and Hawaii. Alabama lawmakers approve hunting deer with bait. This story is from the AL.com website and was reported by Mike Kaysen. A bill to allow hunters to buy licenses to hunt deer and feral hogs over bait has passed the Alabama legislature after several years of falling short. Under current law, hunters must be at least 100 yards away and out of the line of sight of bait. Under the bill that passed today, hunters could buy a bait privilege license that would exempt them from the 100-yard line of sight rule. Alabama hunters would pay a $15 annual fee. Out-of-state residents would pay $51. The bill, by Senator Jack Williams, a Republican from Wilmer, passed the House today by a vote of 83-12. Government Kay Ivey could sign it into law. Representative Danny Crawford, a Republican from Athens, who sponsored the bill in the House, said some hunters already use bait and the law is hard to enforce. Crawford said the license fees would provide revenue for the Department of Conservation and Natural Resources to help protect the state's deer population and the tourism dollars hunters spend in Alabama. He said the agency needs more revenue to guard against chronic wasting disease and other potential threats to deer. Crawford said the bill couldn't provide limited help with the crop destruction and other problems caused by feral hogs. Alabama Department Conservation Commissioner Christopher Blankenship said the department did not initiate the bill but was not opposed to it. Blankenship said lawmakers added an amendment at the department's request to allow the department to suspend baiting privileges in certain areas if there is threat of a disease outbreak. Blankenship said revenues from the privilege licenses would be used for enforcement, research, and efforts to increase public access to hunting. Montana men who killed mountain lion at Yellowstone sentenced to 3 years worldwide hunting ban. This story is from the Fox News website and was reported by Michael Bartiremo. Three men in Montana have been sentenced for illegally hunting a mountain lion at Yellowstone National Park. Austin Peterson, 20, Trey Junkie, 20, and Corbin Simmons, 19, had each previously admitted to shooting the mountain lion in a clearly marked area of the park on December 12, 2018, before bringing the line back over the park's border and into their truck, per a Yellowstone news release. Simmons later changed his tune and claimed he harvested the line outside park boundaries. The men's actions were found to be in violation of the Lacey Act of 1894, per the National Park Services, which prohibits the taking, selling, or purchasing of wildlife from protected areas. On May 3rd, a federal court sentenced Peterson to fines of approximately $1,700, as well as a 3-year probation, throughout which he is banned from hunting, fishing, and trapping worldwide. Junkie and Simmons reportedly received equally harsh sentences at previous hearings in April. A representative from the NPS was not immediately available to confirm whether those sentences were identical. Chief Ranger Pete Webster thanked the agencies responsible for bringing the men to justice. Montana's Fish, Wildlife, and Parks Department, Yellowstone's law officers, and the NPS's investigative branch, and the U.S. Attorney's Office in a press release issued by NPS. In April, a similarly young hunter, age 19, was sentenced to pay fines of nearly $10,000, along with an additional $10,000 mandatory fine for killing and abandoning a moose in Colorado. That concludes this week's edition of the Big Buck Archery's Deer News. Special thanks to Daniel Applebaum and John Geis for leads on stories this week. For links to the stories featured this week, please check our show notes at www.bigbuckregistry.com. If you have any ideas for future topics or have any questions about any of these topics, please email me at jim@bigbuckregistry.com. For the Big Buck Registry, this is Jim Keller with the Deer News.
Well, thanks to Jim Keller for the Deer News. Without further ado, here is Kip Adams with the 2019 QDMA Whitetail Report. Kip Adams, welcome back to the Big Buck Registry's Deer Hunting Podcast. How are you, my friend?
I'm doing well. Thank you for having me back.
We're psyched to talk to you again. This the report that the QDMA puts out every year is very in-depth and covers a lot of great information about the current status of the whitetail population in America. And you're the guy. So we did this last year, and it was really helpful and gives us an understanding of what's going on around the country. So I appreciate you coming back on the show.
Absolutely. I'm glad to be here.
So the information that you put out in the 2019 Whitetail Report is from data that was collected over the 2017 year. Is that correct?
17-18 hunting season. And so it's data that would have ended up, so it was, we published at the beginning of each year. So when we published that in January of 2019, the 2018-19 hunting season was still going on.
Gotcha.
So this was the data that was the most recent hunting season that was completed, that the state wildlife agencies had the data available to give to us.
Gotcha. All right. Very good. Now, you cover Northeast, Southwest, Midwest, West, and Canada. And why break it up like that?
Well, we have always, got data from every state and provincial wildlife agency that would provide it to us. And we're very fortunate now in that we get data from just about every state in the U.S. There's a couple that just either simply don't have whitetails and don't want to share information, but we get it from about everybody. We then break it into the different regions just to try to make it a little bit comparable for folks across the country. And the regions that we actually follow, follow the state wildlife agency technical deer regions. And what I mean by that is each year, the deer biologists in the northeastern U.S. and eastern Canada get together for the Northeast Deer Technical Committee, where the deer biologists from each state meets to discuss issues in their state. Biologists in the southeast do the same thing. The Midwest do the same thing. So some of those states actually overlap, and biologists will attend two different meetings. But for the most part, we broke our whitetail report regions into the same regions that attend those three technical meetings by the state agency deer biologists, because there's obviously differences in cover types and habitat and hunting culture and that. So
right.
We provide all the information in there on a state-by-state basis, but then we group it by regions just to make it a little bit comparable and to have some fun with it.
Gotcha. All right. So the report is 72 pages long, and I'd love to go through all 72 pages, but I think we might lose some listeners if we try to go through the whole thing. So I'd like to stick to some of the highlights and things that you find interesting in this report so people can understand it, and then they can go and obviously download the report from your website and really get into some of the finer aspects of the report itself. What sticks out to you? What's the headliner here?
Well, a couple of the big things that hunters love, and for anybody that's interested, we make these available as a free download at our website, which is qdma.com. And actually, this year is the 11th annual report that we've done. So we started this back in 2009 as a way to provide good, helpful information to hunters and resource managers and the media. Mm-hmm. You know, we see a lot more information today on, you know, what deer they're killing in a certain state, or, you know, folks want to know, hey, how does that compare to my neighbors? How does that compare to other states in our region or other parts of the country? So we started developing these or writing these to provide that information to those hunters. And one of the things that I think is very interesting about this year's report is one question that we ask is what is the age structure, you know, of both the buck and the doe harvest in the different states? Mm-hmm. Because some agencies do a really good job protecting young bucks. Others don't have a big desire to protect young bucks, and so you just don't get many older bucks in those annual harvests. Well, obviously, bucks appeal to hunters, and they want to know what's going on and kind of how their state compares. So what we found was that across the United States, only 35%, so about a third of all of the antlered bucks that were shot were 1.5 years old. Mm. And, going that first set of antlers. And that is very, very different from, a couple of decades ago where the vast majority of the buck harvest was only one. But today, if you take all the bucks killed in the United States, about a third of them are 1.5 years old. About a third of them are 2.5 years old, and a third are at least 3.5. So they're 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 years old. And that is, a very balanced age structure. And some states shoot way more older bucks than others. But on average, that's, across the U.S., a third in each of those age classes. That's pretty cool. And that's provided very different hunting opportunities today than just a short time ago.
Okay. So you see a trend in, and I think we saw this last year too, right? Where in general, there are older bucks being taken in a higher percentage than before.
That's correct. Absolutely.
Okay. What do you attribute to that? What's the sentiment? Is it the hunters are just getting more educated, or that it's just a desire to hunt the older deer and not just go out and kill whatever they see? What do you attribute to that?
I think that there's a couple things that go into that. And one of them, it's been a big cultural change. I grew up in northern Pennsylvania, started hunting in the early 1980s when, you just shot any buck that you saw because almost all the bucks were only 1.5 years old. And we didn't know any better. We only knew to shoot a buck. We had no idea that the value of allowing some of those bucks to get a little older, or even good opportunities we can have to photograph older bucks throughout the year, or then have the chance to chase them in the fall. So through organizations like QDMA and state wildlife agencies have done a much better job educating hunters on, hey, here are the benefits if we have some older bucks out there, and here are the opportunities available to you. QDMA is over 30 years old now, and our mission has been to provide good information to hunters. So over the past 3+ decades, you did have a big cultural shift in hunters moving away from, let's just kill the first buck I see, to, hey, you know what? Let's have an opportunity for a little bit of different type of hunting and be good deer managers or good stewards of these natural resources by making sure there are some older bucks out there.
Right.
So hunters, as much as anything, have driven that shift and that age structure.
Gotcha. And I see that same cultural change almost across the country. Like it seems to be that more and more of that kind of awareness and desire to hunt the older bucks and let the younger ones pass seems to be, the stats are the stats, but it just the overall synopsis seems like that's the idea.
Yes. And today there are 24 states out there that have some type of antler restrictions imposed by the state wildlife agency. And those are restrictions designed to protect yearling bucks, just that first age class of buck. However, almost every single one of those states that have those restrictions were demanded by the hunters. And the hunters went to the agencies and asked them to impose those. Mm. So there are very, very few exceptions to that. Pennsylvania is the one exception where the Pennsylvania Game Commission proposed de-antler restrictions to hunters and then tried to educate hunters on why they would be good. But in almost every other case, they were hunter-driven, self-imposed regulations. So that's quite telling about, you know, what hunters want to see today and what opportunities they want to have when they go hunting.
Gotcha. Which states stick out in as part of that stat that you find intriguing?
There's a group of states in the southeastern U.S., Minnesota, Mississippi, Louisiana, Arkansas, kind of that part of the world.
Okay.
They've really had, Mississippi has had statewide antler restrictions longer than any other state. So they have hunters there that have seen the benefits of protecting young bucks. And then because of that, every year or almost every year, Mississippi leads the country with harvesting the lowest percentage of bucks that are just 1.5. Mm. And the highest percentage of the buck harvest is at least 3.5 years old. So, and it's mostly they've just had an opportunity to hunt under that regime longer. They've had kids that now have never hunted under anything except that regime. So, that's their tradition. That's what they think is normal. So, and they continue to push the envelope there and, you know, and move deer into even older age classes and then reap the benefits by getting to hunt more mature bucks.
Gotcha. All right. What else sticks out as part of this report year over year?
One of the things that we have seen the last few years trending is that hunters in the U.S. have been shooting a higher number of bucks and a lower number of does. There are some states like where you're from, you know, in New England, and you know, I've been with QDMA for almost 20 years now, but prior to that, I was the New Hampshire Fish and Game's deer and bear project leader. So right. I'm very familiar with that part of the world. And certainly in that part of the world, you can have a very successful deer management program by annually harvesting more bucks than you do antlerless deer.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're at the northern limit of Whitetail's range and bad winters, lower productivity habitat than many other regions of the country. So you can do that. However, most of the U.S., that's not the case. You need to shoot more antlerless deer each year than bucks if you're going to continue to have a very healthy deer herd and a very healthy deer program. And what we've been seeing the past few years is actually hunters have been going the other way and shooting more and more bucks and fewer does. And actually, this past hunting season, or I'm sorry, this 2017-18 hunting season is the first year since 1998 that hunters killed more bucks than they did antlerless deer during the hunting season. So that's this trend in fewer and fewer antlerless deer really hit a milestone that in 17-18. And it'll be a historic deer season, one that'll go down in the books that we'll remember forever, in that we have gone back to the old ways by across the country shooting more bucks than antlerless deer. And that is not a positive thing for the future of our deer management programs.
Mm. Explain that a little further. Why is that a detriment?
The way that we control population growth is by harvesting antlerless deer. You know, they're the ones that have the fawns. They're the ones that control how quickly or how slowly a deer herd grows. So we can shoot all the bucks we want, but that really doesn't do that much to balance deer herds with what the habitats can support or to control population growth. So in order to do that, we have to have a very solid program where we shoot the right number of antlerless deer each year. And as hunters, we just have not been doing that. Many states in the U.S. today, you know, before the season starts, they have a target antlerless harvest that they want to achieve to keep deer herd growth either at a stabilized level or at a level that's compatible to what the habitat can support. And hunters just haven't been hitting it. They've been shooting fewer deer than that. So because of that, there's a lot of deer herds growing today that are getting above what states would like to see and are getting above levels that are healthy for the deer and for our long-term hunting opportunities. So if you take a look, you know, take every fawn born in any state this year, my state of Pennsylvania or New Hampshire or Maine or anywhere else, about half of them will be buck fawns and about half will be doe fawns. So to keep those, you know, sex ratios balanced, we want to shoot generally, you know, in about equal numbers of bucks and does. And in most cases, you need to shoot more does and bucks because bucks are kind of like, you know, us. You know, who does it cost more for vehicle insurance or life insurance? You know, guys or girls? You know, with those guys, because we're far more likely to do something stupid and kill ourselves during the year. And it's the same way with bucks. So if deer start their life at about a 1-to-1 ratio, buck fawns and doe fawns, to keep them balanced, we need to shoot more antlerless deer than antlered bucks each year, or sex ratios start to get skewed. So that's what's happening right now in many states. So that's something that we need to correct.
Can you point at any particular state where, or several states where that's occurring?
Sure. A perfect example is Michigan. Particularly the southern lower peninsula of Michigan is some of the best deer habitat in the whole country. And the DNR for years has been begging hunters there to shoot more antlerless deer. And hunters just have not answered the call. They continue to shoot way more bucks than they do antlerless deer each year. And so there are many places in the southern lower peninsula, you know, with exceedingly high deer herds that are being nutritionally deprived. There's just way more deer than there is food available. They're degrading the habitat, you know, and they're just not being able to express their genetic body potential, growth potential, fawn rearing potential, any of that because of it. So it's a culture, you know, where hunters just in the past were unwilling to shoot enough antlerless deer. And it's a habitat that is so productive that they are just pumping a bunch of deer out. So they need more hunters to shoot a lot more antlerless deer, and they need them to do that very soon.
Gotcha. I mean, you always hear about this stuff. Like, we, you know, growing up, you always hear, well, the hunters help manage the herd, and they do. And you try to explain that to a kid, and it still doesn't sink in as a kid until you start to read some of these reports, right? And actually have the scientists report back to you and explain, as you just did, that the, you know, there are spots in the United States where it's getting out of control, and antlerless harvests are going to be a huge part of that. And if you ignore it, that could be detrimental to the herd. And I guess you know, this is one example that you can really sink your teeth into.
No, absolutely. And you know, we hear so much from people who don't hunt that, right. Because you and I know that, hey, you know, hunters are the ones managing deer herds and the ones helping. But those who aren't as familiar with it, you know, we often hear them say, hey, let's let nature take its course, or, you know, let's reintroduce large predators, or there's lots of things we can do. You know, we don't need hunters to manage deer. You know, we didn't used to need that. Well, that's not true at all, Jay. Joe Hamilton, who's the founder of QDMA, and I wrote a chapter for a major deer book, a deer biology and management book, you know, on the history of deer management. And essentially what we showed in there is, you know, back, you know, with the Native Americans, you know, 1500 years ago, do you have any idea how many whitetails, you know, Native Americans killed annually?
I don't.
It was 6 to 7 million. So 1500 years ago, Native Americans were killing between 6 and 7 million whitetails a year. Hmm. And do you know how many we killed last year? We shot under 6 million last year with hunters.
Wow.
So what we show in that chapter is, for, you know, at least the last 2000 years, humans have been the dominant predator of white-tailed deer.
Right.
Sure, we had, you know, more wolves and other things that ate them, but this whole illusion that, you know, well, the large predators used to take care of it before, you know, before Europeans came here and we messed things up. That's not true at all. Humans have killed more deer than anything else for at least the last 2000 years. And given that we have fewer hunters today than we've had in the past, it is all that much more important that the hunters take care of that responsibility today. You know, hunters are providing a tremendous free service to society that goes unnoticed by so many people, and that's unfortunate.
Right, that's a fascinating stat you just shared with us. I mean, to think that the Native Americans killed more deer than we do today, it puts that in perspective. And you know, talking to like Gordon Whittington and how history is, it kind of tells the tale if you go back far enough, and you kind of forget. Because we, you know, you don't think about going back that far in history to figure out, well, what was going on back then. That's really interesting. But I do have a question about that, because there will be skeptics, there will be challenges from the anti-hunting groups or just middle ground that will want to know, well, what's the source of that information. And as a former scientist, proof is in the standard deviation. So, and the source of the information, where does that information come from about the Native Americans killing 6 or 7 million deer annually?
They compound that data from a few different places. One was from Native American middens. So, you know, they're trash piles and where they can dig and from an archaeological standpoint and see, you know, what their life was like, what tools they used. And from that, they can get an estimate on some of the numbers of whitetails that were killed, you know, based on the amount of remains that are left in some of those midden piles. So they can get some of it that way. There are some historical accounts of when once Europeans arrived, the sheer number of deer hides that the Indians were trading to the settlers and the Europeans each year. So those are two of the bigger places, you know, that are documented historical facts okay. that we're able to achieve. I am sure there are other accounts as well as, you know, how they can get some of that. But, you know, that is the estimate based on all of the facts that are available today.
Okay.
And so from that. So, yeah, it's fascinating, you know, to just think that, you know, how important white-tailed deer have been to, you know, North America for, you know, for that long. You know, as somebody who's a deer fanatic, I just think that's one thing or one more reason to be impressed by this creature.
It is fascinating. It probably was a very big piece of our heritage and still is a big piece of our American heritage. But if you look at it historically, it probably built a nation in a lot of ways. And I know that they, you know, you kind of attribute a lot of this stuff, but if you look at beer and deer, both things somehow attributed more than you think, right? They always credit that without beer, there would have been lots of tainted water and that most likely not have survived as much, but the beer killed a lot of the, and wine too. But being able to eat red meat probably advanced our species much further than you think.
For sure. Oh, absolutely.
Let's take a little break. And when we come back, we'll pick up where we left off with Kip Adams from the QDMA.
Rackology Deer Supplement and Attractant, developed through years of intense scientific research, comes a product that puts it all in one bag. Superior attractant, scientifically formulated vitamins and minerals, and all at a much better price. To get yours today, please check out Rackology.org for a list of dealers. Rackology, how can you afford not to use it? Everything deer need, all in one bag.
And now back to our conversation with Kip Adams from the QDMA about the 2019 Whitetail Report. What else sticks out in the report other than the couple things we've talked about so far?
Well, I'm interested to take a look at just some of the timing of the deer harvest and what folks are getting them with. And what we see is today, about 2/3 of all the whitetail shot in the U.S. Are taken with a firearm, you know, either a rifle or a shotgun. And but with archery equipment, it's about a quarter, you know, about a quarter of all the deer. Now, the interesting part of that is that 15 years ago, it was only 15% of the total deer harvest was taken with a bow. So over the last decade and a half, there are a lot more deer being taken with a bow than there were in the past. And that's for a couple of reasons. One is a lot more states today allow crossbow use during archery season, or allow folks, you know, to use crossbows who aren't, you know, they don't need a note from the doctor anymore. We also have a lot longer archery seasons, expanded bag limits. And, you know, as our hunter population ages, and it's much older today than it's been in the past, you know, there's just a lot more people who enjoy being out in September and October rather than December or January. So we're killing a lot more deer today with bows than we ever have, at least in our recorded history.
Funny you say that, because just talking to guys that had started hunting back in the 80s, they're saying, well, you know, back then nobody bow hunted, or so it seems subjectively. And, you know, I wasn't really into bow hunting that much back then. Now I am. The data shows that, right? There's indisputable that bow hunting is more prevalent today than it was back in the 80s.
For sure. And actually, we asked that question in this year's report as well, on a state-by-state basis, you know, the number of bow hunters they have. And we found that there's about 3 million bow hunters in the U.S. And the Midwest as a region has the most. They have more than 1.3 million bow hunters just in the Midwest. However, and I think this is really appealing to me and you, the Northeastern U.S. has the most bow hunters per square mile. We have almost 4 bow hunters per square mile.
Wow. Interesting.
As an average. My home state has the most. There are about 7.5 bow hunters per square mile across the state of Pennsylvania. Now, to put that in perspective, the entire Midwest region only averages about 6 hunters per square mile total. So Pennsylvania has more bow hunters per square mile than the entire Midwest or Southeast has complete or total hunters per square mile. So lots and lots of people here in my home state hunting with a bow. And in the Northeast as a region, more people out there with a bow per square mile than any other place in the United States.
All right, so let's ask the classic question. Why? Why is that occurring? Why has it been trending that way?
Well, the allowed crossbow use has played in a lot of that.
Okay.
But as much as anything, the Northeast just also has more hunters per square mile than anybody else. You know, we have a lot of hunters, you know, a lot of more urban scenarios in the Northeast. So just a place that allows, you know, or we have a landscape that just has a lot of people on it and historically a lot of rural people. So we just have a huge hunting culture in the Northeastern U.S. and more of our people go hunting than any place else.
Very cool. What's your take on the crossbow? I hear mixed emotions between hunters and purists and fish and game. They're not big fans of it because of the silence that it carries for poaching purposes. What's your perspective on the crossbow?
I am a diehard bow hunter. I love to hunt with a bow and have for a long, long time. And my perspective has always been, I understand the need to increase the number of hunters that we have. You know, we're losing hunter numbers. We're losing face with society with regard to, you know, hunters in our country. So my professional opinion is, hey, anything that we can do that will help facilitate more hunters or get more people hunting is a good thing for the future of hunting. So because of that, I'm a fan of of crossbow seasons and allowing people to the opportunity to use crossbows. I have firsthand experience with new hunters, particularly youth hunters, being able to hunt with a crossbow. Our hunting camp in Pennsylvania is a perfect example. My young daughter shoots a bow with me in the backyard, absolutely loves it. My young son shoots bow, loves it. Neither one of them, actually, I guess my daughter probably can now, but my son certainly cannot pull enough weight on his vertical bow to legally hunt with it. However, my daughter has shot 2 deer, deer each of the last 2 seasons with a crossbow. So it enabled her to spend time afield with me, you know, and develop that sportsmanship and wood skills and to develop a love for a hunter, you know, that she could not have done if she were not able to hunt then with it for the crossbow. We also have a member of our camp that is in his 80s, his mid-80s, has hunted his entire life, you know, and is no longer able to pull enough weight on his bow. So he uses a crossbow. So even though that I don't use a crossbow, I am more than happy to share the woods with people who do. So I've just seen too many times the good that a crossbow can do to afford more people more opportunities.
Okay.
Now, I certainly understand it from the poaching end. Until very recently, crossbows, the ballistics just simply didn't afford them the opportunity to shoot much farther than a compound bow anyway. So, you know, that was more of a myth than a reality that people were, you know, poaching a lot with them. However, with these new Raven crossbows, mm-hmm. I do think there's cause for concern there, or at least cause for discussion, where, you know, they are legitimately shooting 3-inch groups at 100 yards. You know, there's some guys in my hunting camp that can't do that with a rifle. And now I know
right.
people who are doing that with a crossbow.
Right.
So that changes the game a little bit and I think does warrant some more discussion. You know, 95 or 99% of the crossbows out there ballistically are very similar to, you know, what a vertical bow can shoot. You know, but they provide somebody, you know, an opportunity to go hunting. And if somebody's not willing to put in the time to be really proficient with a vertical bow, you know, I don't want them slinging arrows at deer just from an ethical standpoint anyway. So,
I agree.
You know, you can get really proficient really quickly with a crossbow, and I'm totally fine with that.
I know New Hampshire, and you'll understand New Hampshire as well as I do, they're very reluctant to open that up to just the regular bow season. And it turns heads when I talk to guys from out of state. Like, what do you mean they're not letting you use a crossbow during bow season? Like, that it's an exception to the rule. It's a handicap kind of thing where you can get it, and you can use it during rifle season, but you can't use it during the bow season. What's your take on that?
Yeah, I think that's just become an antiquated view. Mm-hmm. You know, the majority of states now allow you to use crossbows during archery season for the majority, or at least a portion of the archery season for the majority of hunters. New England kind of has a stronghold on that. Maine and New Hampshire and Vermont and Massachusetts. If you take a look at a map, and actually this was in our 2018 Whitetail Report, it showed, if you take a look at the U.S., everybody in the Northeast except the New England states I just mentioned allows crossbow use for the majority of hunters during archery season. Every state in the Southeast does, and most states in the Midwest do. So it's changing state by state each year, and I think at some point everybody will allow it. There's just a handful of states out there that they're just still kind of holding back, but even though I'm not using a crossbow, I'm for it. I think that they should allow it.
All right. So overall, we're seeing an increasing deer population across the country in every zone. Is that correct?
Not necessarily every region or every state of every zone, but in most of them, yes. Okay. It's kind of, we had declining deer herds for a number of years because of disease, habitat loss, reduced fawn recruitment rates. There was a series, 5 or 6 years in a row where, hey, our deer herds were taking a hit a little bit, but the last few years that's really turned around, and we see a lot of deer herds growing now. But yes, every region of the country has numerous states within that region where deer herds are growing.
Okay. Speaking of disease, where are we at with disease in the country today?
It's one of the biggest issues that are impacting hunters today, because of chronic wasting disease, and CWD continues to expand. It's in 20, or at least we've confirmed it in 26 states now. It continues to grow within states that have it into new areas. We're finding it in new regions of the country. There's a lot of misinformation out there about it, and there's a lot of celebrity hype. Saying, this is not a big deal. The vast majority of wildlife experts, north of 95% of people who work with wildlife, deer managers, disease managers, researchers, look at CWD as one of the biggest issues impacting deer today. There's a very small handful of people who try to convince folks that it's not a big deal, but it's simply not true. This is one of the biggest things to ever impact deer herds, and we're in for the fight of our life right now with CWD. We know that there's no vaccine, there's no cure, and it's 100% fatal to all deer. So those are not good for the future of deer herds. And research, very recent research, shows that deer that have it, in any given year are 2 to 3 times more likely to die than deer that don't have it. So what that means is every deer is going to die from it. They can live a while with it, but we don't tend to see a lot of sick deer, or there's not a lot of deer that officially die from CWD because they die from something else first. They're just more predisposed to predation or vehicle kills or hunter kills. So, the critics say, well, if they're dying from something else, it's not a big deal. But that's not true. The deer manager will say, hey, anything that makes an animal 2 to 3 times more likely to die in any given year, that is a huge deal.
Right.
If I told you for all the moose in New Hampshire, they're 2 to 3, a certain segment are 2 to 3 times more likely to die, or the bear or turkey, hunters recognize that, like, wow, that is really bad. And CWD is the real deal. We are dedicating tremendous resources to try to learn more about it and help hunters with that. And it's something that hunters really need to pay attention to, because it's not going away anytime soon. And it's going to be impacting everybody's hunting sooner rather than later.
Do we have an estimate on when the first case of CWD occurred that we can study?
Well, we know the first one that they found was in the late 60s. We're not sure, Was that the very first case? Probably not. You know, you almost never find the first case of any disease like that. But there's very good data to suggest, you know, that that this has not been here forever. That it's something, you know, that started somewhere, you know, in that 1960s time frame, and then we found it late in the 60s and early in the 70s, and then it has been growing like crazy since then.
It's funny you mentioned that, but the CWD is a weakening agent, right? It's not necessarily going to kill the deer. It'll weaken the deer, much like the winter tick has weakened the moose, and the moose population had declined dramatically in the Northeast because of the winter tick. And because of that, the number of tags, the number of moose that are here, and for quite a while, the moose that I would see were so, they look anemic, and I guess they were. And it wasn't so much that the tick killed them, but that it weakened them so much that something else killed them.
That is a good analogy. CWD will eventually kill a deer if something else doesn't first, because it essentially eats holes in the deer's brain. But you're exactly right. Oftentimes, you know, before it does finally kill them, the weakening process allows something else to kill them first.
Right. Very interesting. And I know it's super controversial, and we've got celebrity hunters talking about it. We've got scientists making claims that may or may not be true. We've got, this is zombie deer from the media has really taken off, and it just seems like it is true. It is a real disease. And if it's not carefully taken seriously, or if it's not taken seriously, it could influence herds like we don't want them to.
For sure. That's absolutely right.
Okay. Anything else stick out in the report that is striking year over year, or just a trend that you'd like to point out that has happened, not necessarily from last year to this year, but just overall?
I think one of the cool things in there, and of course we're hunters too, so we want to put stuff in there that hunters find that's cool. One of the things that we took a look at is the percentage of hunters that are actually successful each year. And it really varies state by state. But what we found is that about 40% of hunters in any given year kill a deer. Hmm. You know, so less than half. And that ranged from 12% in Arizona to almost 70% in South Carolina. But can you imagine living in a state like South Carolina where almost everybody does kill a deer, and then move to a state where almost nobody does? Because I'm sure people in Arizona, you know, about 1 out of 10 each year kill a deer, and that's very normal. I vividly remember in the early 90s being in New Hampshire where, you know, almost nobody killed a deer. You know, you had a good season if you saw a deer in a year. And that's very different now. But coming from Pennsylvania, where almost everybody killed a deer, when I went to New Hampshire, where, you know, you were lucky to see one, that was a very different experience. So it's pretty cool just to see, like, how the states compare with the numbers of hunters that are successful. We added on to that and said, okay, so we found that about 40% of all hunters kill a deer a year. So we asked, you know, like, what percentage kill more than one deer? And this was really surprising. Only 15% of the hunters in the United States kill more than one deer a year. So
really?
If you shot two deer last year, you are in an absolute market. You know, and this is including all the states, you know, the Pennsylvanias, the Iowas, you know, the Georgias, and everywhere in between. So, you know, hunters are, in general, way less successful than many realize. You know, even many hunters realize. Perfect example is in Georgia, when you buy your hunting license, you get the opportunity to shoot 10 antlerless deer and $2.
Right.
So the reaction by many is, oh my God, they're going to, you know, wipe the deer herd out. But the reality is, you know, less than half of the hunters in Georgia even kill one deer.
Right.
Even though they have a back limit of 12, you know, they don't even get one. So we throw things like that in. They help from a management end, but that's pretty cool facts for hunters to take a look at too. And there's all kinds of other tidbits of information like that in there that, you know, if you're a deer hunter, it's pretty cool to take a look at.
Right. That's a very fascinating statistic. I did not realize that. That's cool. Very neat. What's just kind of breaking down the five segments that you guys study, what's the biggest issue in Canada these days?
Oh, probably winter kill.
Okay.
You know, they're right at the limit of whitetails range. So, you know, easy winters and early green ups, you know, those deer herds start to grow. boy, as soon as, you know, you get a bad winter or a late green up, you know, just like you guys can see in northern New Hampshire. And so they get hammered. So it's a lot harder for them than through much of Canada, not all of Canada, certainly not extreme southern Canada, but for much of Canada, it's just really hard to try to stockpile any deer. You know, it's so easy for just one bad winter to take away, you know, what you've tried to save for a few years.
Gotcha. All right. What about the Northeast? I know that covers a lot of states with a large variety of climates, Maine down to Virginia. What are the biggest issues there?
CWD, I would say, is right at the very top. You know, it's grown like crazy in Pennsylvania. You know, it luckily has not been found again in New York, but and I hope that it's never found in New England. But CWD is at the top of the list for about every region of the country, unfortunately.
Okay. The Southeast, Texas, all the way over to North Carolina. What are the biggest issues affecting those states?
Right now, I think a lot of it is flooding. Holy cow. There's a, you know, once you get out of the north, winter isn't nearly as big of a deal for deer herds. And, you know, if you're not from the south, you kind of forget about, man, there's some other pretty severe habitat or environmental factors that affect those deer. You know, in a lot of South Texas, you know, those deer get so little rain that rainfall drives everything for them, you know, with regard to, you know, how good of a fawn crop you'll have. You know, will only 10% of the fawns make it, or will 50%? So there's a lot of other things that we don't think about in the north, because, you know, I think it's easy in the south. But some of that weather that they get, both ends of it, drought and flooding, really drives those deer herds.
Okay. Midwest, Nebraska over to Ohio. What's driving the concern there?
A lot of that is habitat loss. You know, well, that part of the country, the cover is probably the most restricting habitat feature that they have, particularly in the agricultural Midwest. You know, they have tons of food, but cover is pretty limited. And now that so many of those states have taken a lot of land out of CRP to put back into, you know, the Conservation Reserve Program, you know, the best federal wildlife habitat program ever developed. You know, they're pulling lands out of that and putting them back into row crop agriculture. There's a lot of places in the Midwest that are really taking it on the chin from a cover perspective and loss of habitat.
Okay. And finally, the West, Colorado out to California.
That, you know, there's a lot of issues in that part of the world simply with the non-hunters and anti-hunting sentiment. The West has a lot of big, wide-open places, but there's not many hunters there. You know, the whole Western U.S. only averages about one hunter per square mile, which means there's not a lot of advocates out there for hunting. So they deal with a lot of anti-hunting issues at a much higher level than a lot of us east of the Rockies have to deal with.
Gotcha. Excellent. I think that's a pretty good summary of what's going on in your report, Kip. If people have more questions and want to get more into the really nitty-gritty of the data, where can we go and download this report?
They can go right to QDMA.com, and we have all 11 of those annual whitetail reports are there for a free download, so they can go and grab any of that they'd like.
Very cool. Kip, thanks for coming back on the show and breaking this down and some of the highlights, and we'll have you back on next year to break down the 2020 report.
All right, Jay, that sounds great. It's good talking to you.
I look forward to having Kip on each and every year. That QDMA Whitetail Report is a really good book. And I say book because there's a lot of data and details in there, but it helps us follow the trends that are occurring year after year in the United States relative to the things that we like on this show, which is whitetail deer hunting. So not that we're just whitetail, but obviously it's a large piece of hunting across the United States. So we'll have Kip on each and every year to give us the rundown, the synopsis, the snapshot of all the highlights in that report each and every year. And of course, you can always go to the QDMA website and download it for yourself. Dusty, where can we find you when you're not hanging out here in the studios with me?
Shoot me an email, dusty@bigbuckregistry.com. You can look me up on Instagram and Twitter @ChasingAntler, facebook.com/ChubbyTinesOutdoors. Jay, where can the people reach out to you when you're not on the mic?
Likewise, you can shoot me an email, jay@bigbuckregistry.com, and you can visit us on Facebook, facebook.com/bigbuckregistry. We're also on Twitter, which is twitter.com/bigbuckregistry. We are also on Instagram, instagram.com/bigbuckregistry, and YouTube, which is youtube.com/bigbuckregistry. On YouTube, you can listen to all of our podcasts in their entirety. As far as videos are concerned, it's a boring video, but the audio content is there, so you can actually listen to our podcast. You can also listen to all of our live shows that we've done on Thursday nights when we do them, and we've gone back and re-interviewed a lot of our previous guests we had on the show just to put a face to a voice. Let's put it that way. You can always listen to our show on other places as well, not just YouTube. We're found on Stitcher, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, Spotify, Google Play, and as an Amazon Alexa skill. Go to Alexa and say, "Alexa, enable Big Buck Registry." And if you would like to submit a buck to our page for consideration and be featured on our page in front of 250,000 diehard deer hunting fans, all you have to do is go to bigbuckregistry.com/mybuck, and all of the instructions will be right there. I think that's pretty much everywhere we're at. I think that's a wrap, Dusty.
That's a whole lot of big buck, Jay.
Sure is. I'm Jay Scott.
I'm Dusty Phillips.
And this is the Big Buck Registry's Deer Hunting Podcast. We'll see you next week.